الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم اغفر وارحم وتجاوز عما تعلم إنك أنت العز الأكرم. اللهم ارحمنا فإنك بنا راحم والطف بنا بما جرت به المقادير يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم اجعل هذا القرآن نور صدورنا وربيع قلوبنا وجلاء أحزاننا وذهاب همومنا. اللهم علمنا منه ما جهلنا وذكرنا منه ما نسينا واجعله اللهم حجة لنا لا حجة علينا. Dear brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inshallah, we continue today with Tafseer Surat Ad-Duha. Last week, we mentioned that Surat Ad-Duha is a Meccan surah. And also, Surat Ad-Duha is one of the early surahs. So it is the 11th. Surah that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also there are reasons for the revelation of the surah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had time when the revelation was late. And during this time, some of the people in Quraysh, it is narrated that they said the Lord of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam deserted him, and a woman said the same. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed that surah. Excuse me for a minute. So there were a couple of occasions that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not have the revelation. So what happened is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam received the first wahi, the first revelation, and then there was a lull, and there was a period of no revelation, and then there was the revelation resumed, and then there was a second time when the revelation eased, and then Ad-Duha came after that, wallahu alam. So there were a couple of times that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not receive revelation, in the sense that there were periods of time when the revelation stopped, and this is also to train the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because revealing Al-Wahi, revealing the revelation, is very demanding, and it's heavy on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, particularly at the beginning of time, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not know what was coming to him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to make it easy for him, and also to make the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam look forward to the revelation and to the wahi, as we perhaps explained some of that last week. The surah, as we started it last week, it begins with an oath by the forenoon and the oath by the night, and then the subject of the oath is مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى, your Lord has neither forsaken you nor hated. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the good news that from now on everything, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him وَلَا الْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى, the what is coming in the future will always be better than the present. And we did say that it refers to the hereafter and the Jannah compared with the world, but also it refers to all the status and the situations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam during his life, that what is to come is always better. So it is, what he is in is good, but he will have even better time in the future. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا سَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى, and verily your Lord will give you so that you shall be well pleased. This is the ayah where we stopped at. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا سَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى, and your Lord shall give you so as you in a sense that you will be pleased, and verily your Lord will give you so that you shall be well pleased. And yu'tika here also is a general term, is a verb, yu'tika, and it is in the present tense, and it is in the continuous sense and tense. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall always give the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, first of all, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving him is not mentioned, so it is general. So it refers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving him the prophethood, the message, the Quran, giving him the best ummah following him. And giving him all the good things in general. So it is giving him the best akhlaq, the best moral conduct, giving him the revelation, giving him the sharia, giving him Islam, giving him a huge ummah until the day of judgment, and also giving him and his ummah after him. So وَلَا سَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى is also a reference not only to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because these good things, because of the fellowship of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, will also be given to his followers. So his sahaba, his companions after him, were the son of guidance to all humankind. They were the leaders, they were the givers, they were the best raised, and those who follow them, who followed them, and until the day of judgment, whoever follows Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he will be given like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the honor of guidance, the honor of Islam to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the honor of believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messengers and his books, the day of judgment, the angels, the faith, the honor of receiving Al-Quran and reciting Al-Quran, and the bounty and the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is received by whoever submits his will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and accepts Islam. وَلَا سَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the most obstinate of the people. So he had very little from this world, and he was never looking for worldly gains. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was keen to see his companions guided, and to see his people guided, and to see more and more people guided to Islam and submitting their will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala details some of these favors. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. Did he not find you an orphan and gave you a refuge? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was born an orphan. Yatiman, being yatim, it means an orphan. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam for sure was the master of all orphans in the world. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam being an orphan gives all the orphans in the world the honor, because such an orphan who, because being an orphan is a weakness, it means that there is this continuation from the parents' viewpoint, from the father viewpoint. There is perhaps poverty attached to being an orphan. There is a lack of being looked after. So all of these meanings are attached with the word orphan, yatim. And yet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, despite all of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looked after him. أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. Did he not find you an orphan and give you a refuge? Let's just take a very quick glance at the beginning of the Prophet's life, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We know that his father, Abdullah, he passed away while he was in the womb of his mother. So he was orphaned even before he came out to this world. And then he was orphaned by the death of his mother Khadija, his mother Amina. So Amina, the Prophet's mother, also died. Amina bint Wahab died when he was 6 years of age. By that time, his grandfather, Abdul Muttalib, who loved him so much, looked after him. He was in the custody of his grandfather, Abdul Muttalib, who looked after him from the age of 6 until the age of 8, because Abdul Muttalib then passed away. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was in the custody of his uncle Abu Talib, and Abu Talib looked after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was in his household, he raised him with his children, he loved him so much, he looked after him, he was always keen to give him the best of everything he had. Abu Talib was not a rich man. He was not rich at all, and he had many children. But yet, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in that household. He was loved. He was very well looked after, and Abu Talib did everything to give Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam the best after his father passed away, as we mentioned, when he was in the womb of his mother, after his mother passed away when he was 6, after his grandfather passed away when he was 8, and then now he is in the custody and he is in the he's being looked after and loved, very much loved, by his uncle Abu Talib. Until the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 40, Abu Talib loved him and defended him and looked after him. And even after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam announced that he received the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he is the messenger of Allah. He was rejected by Quraysh, the majority of Quraysh, the majority of the elite of Quraysh. Abu Talib himself did not embrace Islam, as we know from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yet Abu Talib was defending the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam all the while, and even he resisted the offer by Quraysh to give him one of their best sons, and that Abu Talib gives them Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam instead, and he said, أعطيكم ابني لتقتلوه وتعطوني ابنكم لأغذوه لكم. Shall I give you my son, referring to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so as you managed to kill him? Because that was the plan. Quraysh wanted to get rid of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then you give me your son so as I feed him and look after him. And he rejected that. And all the offers and temptations and challenges from Quraysh were opposed by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and supported by Abu Talib until the time that Abu Talib passed away. Also, during this time, we need to remember and understand, أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. So all of these stages, as I mentioned, is being an orphan, but yet being looked after by the mother, by the grandfather, by the uncle. And also the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the age of 25 got married to Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiyallahu anha, and she loved him and she shared her wealth with him, and she looked after him, and she believed and embraced Islam as the first woman in Islam. She was the best wife to the best husband of the time and of all times. And the year of sorrow, or the year of sadness, when Abu Talib passed away, and the same year Khadija radiallahu anha passed away, then that year was named and branded as the year of sorrow, the year of sadness, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very sad, and he lost his companion and wife Khadija radiallahu anha, and also he lost his uncle, who was defending him against Quraysh and against the attacks, verbal and physical, and the mockery of Quraysh. But subhanallah, by that time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permitted him to immigrate to Al-Madinah, and then Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj, these people who came to Mecca around the time of the year of sadness, and after that they gave him bay'ah, covenant, and then they accepted to receive the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his sahaba, and they were looking after him. They shared their al-Madinah with him and with the sahaba radiyallahu anhum. They shared their wealth, they shared their homes and houses and businesses with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the sahaba. So, أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. Did he not find you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, an orphan, and gave you a refuge? If you look at the very beginning, if someone is orphaned, you think, you know, that child lost their parents or lost a father, you'll think that what future will that person have? And yet look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looked after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, stage after stage, after the loss of the father, after the loss of the mother, and then the grandfather took him into his custody, and then the uncle. And I also need to mention that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was raised as a poor person, and there was a custom at that time that women from from around Mecca used to come and take the newly born children as nursing mothers. And of course, they did that so as they may be given some gifts and some money. They never, of course, it wasn't habitual, and they did not put a price. They never put a price. They just accepted to have these children, thinking that there will be some gifts in return. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, at the very beginning, because he did not have people behind him who are rich, he was not picked by these nursing mothers or nursing women, but Halima al-Sa'diyya loved him and took him and nursed him. She was his wet mother, and he was very well looked after at that time, subhanallah. And she was talking about all the favors and all the, if you like, good things that happened to her while Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in her lab, and she was breastfeeding him. Her life turned to be blessed and to be happy, and she looked after him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, dear brothers and sisters, He works. Allah will look after you. You may not think so. You may not know that, but Allah will always do that. And one of the names of Allah is Al-Latif. Al-Latif, there is the subtle. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks after us in a subtle way that we may not know. And of course, this is a prime example of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looking after our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the very, very beginning, of course, until the very, very end. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looked after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam throughout all his life, from one stage to another. So these are just examples, dear brothers and sisters. أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. Now, the word dal means astray. One of the meaning of dal means astray. But literally, in the Arabic language, dal means the one who goes astray from the path. So if someone goes looking for something or looking for an address and they did not find it, or they went from one town to the other and they could not reach the other town because they took the wrong turns, then we call that dal. So, and dal also, it means the one who forgets. بَلْ ضَلُّ عَنَّا or أَنْ تَضِلَّ إِحْدَاهُمَا in Surah Al-Baqarah, that one of the two women witnesses, if she forgets, then the other woman will remind her. But here, and this is the only position in the Quran that this word was attributed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why I'm really, before I'm going to translate the ayah, I'm just making you aware of the meaning of dal. أَلَمْ وَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. And for sure, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his throughout his life until he was 40 and receiving the wahi, the revelation, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was on the instinct, on al-fitra, and he was praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he was on al-hanifiyyat al-samha. So he was praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's why he used to go to ghar حراء يتحنف. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to take some food and something with him, and he used to go there to the cave and spend a few days, and that is before Islam, praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and looking to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one and only. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even before Islam, and that is the case for all prophets and messengers, even before they receive the revelation, the wahi, these people are on believing in one God. They don't do anything which is morally wrong or inappropriate. They have high moral conduct. They come from a good lineage. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was one of these chosen prophets, and he is the chosen one, Al-Mustafa. So what is the meaning of that ayah? That, you know, when you read something, you need to think of the tafsir. Of course, alhamdulillah, the tafsir is available, but you know, you may get a question, or you think, why here is wajadaka dallan, and found you dallan, and guided you. So what is the meaning of this ayah? There are six possible meanings of the word or tafsir for this ayah. I quote four of them to you. The first is dallan is an al-wahi wal-shari'a wal-iman wal-Qur'an, that you were unaware. So dallan in this case, it means that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was unaware of al-wahi, revelation, unaware of Islam as sharia and as deen, unaware of iman in its details, that we said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is muwahid even before he receives the revelation. He's unaware of Al-Quran, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was unaware even about any other religion, such as the Judaism or Christianity. He did not learn any of that at all. And there was one or two people who were seeking the truth in his life. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never had any detailed knowledge of that. So from that viewpoint, he was unaware of the revelation. And here you may find in the tafsir, and he found you unaware of the Quran, its legal laws, prophethood, iman, Quran, and so on. So that is being dallan, which means that you did not know, you were unaware of that guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of revelation, in terms of books, and in terms of Al-Quran itself, in terms of the laws and even the ways to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the details of the deen. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not know. And that actually is a strength. As by the way, being an orphan is a strength, because all of that, it means, and being, of course, illiterate is a strength. All of that to point to the fact that it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who looked after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who taught him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who was... who guided him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who gave him the knowledge. And anyone in that sort of situation could not have achieved without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will and help. So that gives the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam an advantage, that he was unaware of any books, he was even illiterate. And to come up with this could not be from him. It must be from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is, by the way, the majority of Mufassirun are on this opinion, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was unaware of the details of deen, the revelation, because even when he received the revelation for the first time, he did not know what that was. He never expected anything. He had no knowledge of revelation. That's why when Khadija radiallahu anha took him to her cousin, Waraq ibn Nawfal, who was on the Abrahamic religion, he knew the Torah and he knew the books, the Injil before. He said, this is the same angel that came to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, and he meant to previous prophets and messengers. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam did not know that. Hence, the word dalan in this case means unaware. And there is an ayah you may find also in Al-Quran quoted by the Mufassirun, because one of the first things that we do tafsir is use Al-Quran itself to do tafsir to Al-Quran in another part. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ رُوحًا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابُ وَلَا الْإِيمَانِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we have revealed to you, but we have made it وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ رُوحًا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابُ وَلَا الْإِيمَانِ. And indeed we have revealed to you ruh, which is the revelation from our order. You did not know what the book and what is iman. So the prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, before that moment in time, he did not know, and hence the meaning of dalan fahada. And also in the beginning of Surah Yusuf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he has revealed this book to him. وَإِن كُنْتَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ لَمِنَ الْغَافِلِينَ. And before that you were unaware. And indeed, this is how we need to understand the word وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you were unaware, you did not have any previous knowledge, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you the knowledge of Al-Quran, the knowledge of deen, the knowledge of iman, the knowledge of law of Islam, and so on. But just to say other meanings of dalan that are possible meaning, the other meaning is dalan yani nasin, يعني you forgot. ضل عن الشيء is to forget it. And I quoted in آية التدايون, in the longest آية in Al-Quran, in سورة البقرة, يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا تداينتم بدين إلى أجل مسمى فاكتبوه. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if you don't find one witness, then you find two female witnesses. أَن تَضِلَّ إِحْدَاهُمَا, so as if one of them forgets, then the other one will remind them. فَتُذَكِّرَ إِحْدَاهُمَا الْأُخْرَى. Also, another meaning of ضَلًا is to lose the way physically. Someone looking for a way, or you are traveling and you lose away. And it was narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam may have lost when they were traveling in one of the travels before the revelation for trading. He lost his way. Now that could be, and there is also another meaning that when he was a boy or a child and in the custody of Abu Talib, he was lost and he was looking for him, etc. Although the isnad, the chain of this may not be true, and even if that story is true, it may not really be what this ayah means. The other meaning, which is very much applicable, is dallan wajadaka dallan, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided your people and your companions by you, because they were misguided. And in this case, this is the real misguidance, because the majority of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam before Islam, they were people who on the religion of their ancestors. Some worshipped the idols, some did this, some did that. They were among the people who were misguided. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and they were guided by the will of Allah by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Allah guided his misguided people and Sahaba and the people around him at the time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided them with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that very much goes with the first possible meaning, which, and he found you unaware of the Quran and the legal laws and the prophethood and Iman, and then he guided you. So he guided you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided your people and guided the Sahaba, and until the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is guiding people with the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. And he found you poor and made you rich, self-sufficient, with self-contentment, etc. Now, وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. Al-'a'il, it means two things in the Arabic language, at least two things. The first one is that having too many children, al-'a'il. And the other meaning is that someone who is less well-off or poor. And in the past, these went side by side. People who had too many people to look after usually did not have enough wealth to look after their children with. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى, that he found you poor and made you rich. وَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in As-Sahihain, and also you can find this hadith in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس الغني عن كثرة العرض ولكن الغني غني النفس. ليس الغني عن كثرة العرض لكن ولكن الغني غني النفس. Richness is not having many possessions, but richness is being content with oneself. So, and of course, فَأَغْنَى, and made you rich, it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all gave him all the favors and elements of being rich. And the first one, for sure, is self-contentment. Self-contentment is extremely important, because there are people who may have a lot, but they don't feel that they have a lot. They always feel that they are missing something. They need more. And they're not as rich as the others, always looking at those who are above them rather than looking at those who are below them in worldly possessions, and being thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we mentioned, he was most obstinate of all people he did not have that eagerness for worldly things. And later on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him so much, and yet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whatever he received, he gave away. And we read stories, of course, at the beginning of the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was raised as an orphan, he was poor, for sure. He was looked after his grandfather and then his uncle. His uncle himself was poor. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Khadija radiallahu anha, asked about a person who is who can look after her trading. And then they pointed out to her Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he started to trade for her, and he did very well. And then she got married to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So from that moment in time, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was well off. He became well off. And then da'wah and receiving the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are expenses, and those around him, they needed to look after that part of da'wah financially as well as from other aspects, until the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immigrated. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immigrated to Al-Madinah, again, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left everything behind him. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they left everything behind them. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started again, not having a lot. And yet the Prophet ﷺ was always having self-contentment with what he had. And then things opened up, and the Prophet ﷺ, he had a lot, but he always gave that away. We remember a story that he had a herd of sheep between two mountains. And a man was looking at that herd. Remember, this is the wealth of the time. And even nowadays, the wealth in a few countries. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, "Do you like that?" He said, "Yes." He said, "It's for you." So he gave that to the man who took the herd in front of him, and drove the herd of sheep in front of him, went to his people and said, "Aslimu fa inna Muhammadan yu'ti ata'a man la yakhafu al-faqa." Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is giving in a sense that he does not fear poverty. Wajadaka 'a'ilan fa aghna. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as they say, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam combined between al-faqir al-sabir wal-ghani al-shakir. So he had the two states or status of being poor and patient, and also he was rich and he was grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when he died, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not leave anything. He would have given everything he had away. وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. And also that goes to his ummah, that and his Sahaba at the very beginning of time, his companions who had nothing or very little, particularly when they immigrated and then things became better for them until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed him between East and West that Islam will occupy a huge part of earth, and that his ummah will also be given in the sense that وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى, and he found you poor and he made you rich, self-sufficient, with self-contentment. Also on this, I think it's good to say that Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم lived a life. He always wanted to live a life of a very simple lifestyle. So his lifestyle was very simple. And one story that he was sleeping on reed, which is very thin mattress, if you like, or mattress made of reed. And you could see the marks on the body and the face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Sahabi saw him and he said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, we could have done this to you. We could have brought you more comfortable mattress." He said, "Mali dunya, mali wa mali dunya, ma mathali wa dunya illa karakibin istadalla tahta dhilli shajaratin thumma mada." He said, "I have very little to do with this world. My exemplitude is like a traveler who is traveling and he found a tree. So he rested under the shade of the tree for a few moments and then he continued." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew and he manifested the real meaning, "Wala al-akhiratu khayrun laka min al-ula." And indeed, the hereafter is better for you than the present. And all of that, by the way, if you look, these are some of the favors that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam of his favors, of the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon him. They also comply with what we said in ayah number 5. In ayah number 4, وَلَلْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. The future will always be better than the present. So in the past, he was an orphan, and in the present, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him the prophet of Allah, and he is the seal of all prophets and messengers. He gave him Al-Quran. He gave him the best people around him. And he was poor, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even gave him the choice of living until the day of judgment and go to Jannah or die. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he died, he was at the utmost of his status in terms of prophethood and message and piety and all the qualities that you may find in a chosen prophet was in him. So he had always manifested this ayah in him from all aspects. He was unaware, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the truth upon him and chose him as the final prophet and messenger. He was poor, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. He had lost his father and mother and close relatives, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the Sahaba around him in Mecca and then in Al-Madina, Al-Qaws and Al-Khazraj, and then later on that base until the day of judgment. People say, "Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad." They praise him and remember him and make dua for him. So that is also the manifestation of that what is to come is always better than the present. And of course, what is to come in Al-Akhirah, in Al-Jannah, is far better than this dunya. وَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. I think we ought to stop here, inshallah, ayah number 8. And inshallah, we will continue the 3 more ayat next week by the will of Allah, if Allah gives life. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim fil alamin innaka hamidun majid. Jazakallahu khayran والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Allah, 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 Allah.